Okay, good morning. Good to have you in our service here this morning. Good to have you that are watching here on the DVDs. It's good to have you aboard. We're starting a new series now, and it is on this young earth, a thing that didn't exist clear back in the 20s and that. And then all of a sudden, we have some folks that came up with it, and actually, according to the encyclopedia and that, we find out that a person by the name of George McCready Price and Ellen G. White, who founded Seventh-day Adventists, were the ones that come up with this thing here about a young earth. Usually before that, there was only two things. One, there was the teaching, which was good sound teaching about, and if you'll notice up here, well, we have the diagram up here, you find out that at that time, clear back there, there was two main teachings until this came up with Ellen G. White, founder of Seventh-day Adventist occult religion. It came up, they taught that there was a gap principle. In other words, you find out that the original creation, and we're going to get on this and show you the Hebrew and so forth on this, how that this has mushroomed into a young earth, that this never existed before, absolutely denying scripture in the Bible, and that God just simply created this. Now, as we go on, we're going to show you their philosophy and so forth. I want to get into that just a little bit, but they always taught the gap principle. This is the original creation from Isaiah chapter 14 and Ezekiel chapter 28, where the angels were on this earth before man was ever created. They were on here, doesn't give how long they were on there. These were the first created creatures that God created. They had some kind of bodies because we find out the anointed cherub who God had appointed over all of the angels that were created, hundreds and thousands of angels. He rebelled and said, I want to be like the Most High God. And he would even settle to be equal with God. And then God, to make a long story short, before we get into the scriptures and that on this, because there's something else I want to cover first. I'm just giving you the highlights here now. Then God disembodied these angels, all angels, and then God created hell for the devil and his angels. That's before Adam and Eve were ever created. Then there was a gap period of time. God put this in a chaotic condition so that it would never be inhabited by the angels again. They were thrown. This was a Garden of Eden. Here, forget the Garden of Eden on Adam and Eve, that's another Garden of Eden, but this was a Garden of Eden. It had all the precious stones, I mean, they had everything. God made them spirit beings, cleansed this original creation, and put it where it was uninhabitable. Then, we don't have the length of time. God didn't give the time from the time, how long they were on here, how long they were before Satan rebelled, how long they were after God judged that rebellion. We don't know how long it was there. He judged that before he remodeled the earth for human beings. We don't know. The time is not given. Could have been millions of years, billions of years. I don't know. God didn't see fit to put the time in there. This is all denied by your young earth. They say that God just created it like this. But we're going to find as we study that, that's absolutely contrary to the scriptures. Now, it come along, there was another teaching. That was the proper teaching that the gap principle was here. And this earth laid in this chaotic condition, uninhabitable. In fact, on the first 4 days of creation, I should say, in Genesis chapter 1, is not a creation at all. It's a remodeling of the earth. And that's why you find the word made, Asha, which means remodeled from pre-existing materials, or it existed before. Not created, which is a Hebrew word, bara, B-A-R-A, which means never existed before. So the first 4 days of remodeling the earth God used exactly the right Hebrew word, which was Asa. From, they had existed before, God is now going to bring it back into light. And we're going to show you that when it comes to, on the original creation with the angels, the sun and the moon and the stars were already created prior to man being put on the earth. And you'll find as we're going to study, and we'll get into that in detail when we progress a little bit longer, the word far as created is never used with the greater, the lesser light, or the stars. It is Asa. They were already in existence. God blotted them out because there was nothing on when he put this in an uninhabitable condition. They were blotted out because there was no use for them. So, he didn't create the stars and the moon and the sun, but he brought them back into focus for humanity here. And it's why he used the word Asa. They had already been existing. They were blotted out, then they were brought back, but they had already been created on the original creation. This is the importance of the Hebrew, that God chose just the right words to tell exactly what took place. Your young earth people deny all of this, all of it, and just say, man and the earth are 6,000 years old approximately, both, and they deny any original creation with the angels, and they sidestep explaining about the angels and so forth because there is no explanation for it. Very tricky. This is brought in by Ken Ham, one of your guys that come from Australia over here down just south of the Ohio River and around Covington, Kentucky, outside there, has this great museum down there. They had a split over in Australia and had some lawsuits over that of him taking, I think, some money or something out of what they used to have over there. Come to America. Why did he come to America? Let me tell you why he came to America. We got the dumbest people on the Bible you've ever seen in the world. Why do we have the dumbest people on the Bible that you've ever seen? This is not an insult to you, because you're going to learn this stuff. Because we got preachers that don't study. We have the great preachers that taught these things clear back, and I'm going to give those names to you, many of these great Bible teachers. They're ones that followed them, went with the crowd, instead of teaching the Bible, and do not do their own studying. That's why America's in the shape it's in, truthfully, is preachers. They don't take a stand. Most of your preachers now, and I'm not saying 100%, Lordship salvation. Like we had a man call us, and he was from Texas, I think I related this to some of you, and he said, I trusted Christ as my Savior 20 years ago. Remember, I don't know, I'm sure you remember this. And he got on our website. We said, yes, you can be a backslidden Christian. You can't tell a Christian that is a Christian from a lost person, because they have disintegrated from quenching, and they've quenched the Holy Spirit, and they're serving the old nature. Yet they could be a Christian. Let me ask you something. You would never think that Lot was a believer, would you? Out of there in Sodom and Gomorrah? I mean, he even offered his two daughters to be prostituted by these pedophiles and homosexuals. And yet God said in the New Testament, you wouldn't have known that this man was a believer, but he was so far gone that he looked up, he walked by sight, he looked at Sodom, he looked at Gomorrah, and said, man, look at all of these big cities. These are nice. Man, this is where I need to go. And he went. He couldn't even win his own family and sons-in-laws and so forth. Then we find out God said, Lot vexed his righteous soul among those. He didn't have a righteous soul in him anywhere, except in the position that he had trusted God. Yes, he's in heaven, but he sure doesn't have any rewards, does he? No, he lived in Sodom and Gomorrah, lived with all these pedophiles and homos and so forth, offered his daughter. He was about as low as you can get. Yet, the man was still saved. You can take a Christian who gets out of fellowship, and you will think they were never saved. This man that called me from Texas, he said, you know what? He said, I got on your website and you were talking about the old nature and the new nature. You can serve one of the two. You have the free will to do that. And you can get out of fellowship and rebel against God and still be saved, but you're forgetting all of what you do after you're saved. When you're saved, every sin you've committed is paid for eternally. But if you run a stop sign out here, you're going to tell the policeman, hey, I'm a Christian. My sins are paid for. And he's not going to give you a ticket, huh? God says, all right, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are passed away. All things become new. God looks upon you absolutely brand spanking new. Your past is buried in the depths of the sea. Your past is forgotten completely. But now what you do with your life from then on determines not whether you go to heaven. Heaven is never a reward. It is a free gift. You're saved by grace through faith, not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, bought and paid for. Not of works, lest any man should boast. But now if you want rewards, you have to earn them by serving and putting the Lord first. That's what you have to do. So you have a choice in your Christian life. Am I going to put the Lord first? I want to serve Him, have the peace of God that passeth all understanding. Do I really want peace in my life? I thank God for what He's done for me. Or am I going to serve the flesh? The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Many people will go that direction depending upon who they're influenced by. Amos 3:3 says, you will become who you associate with. Can two walk together except they agree? We're talking about continually having, being with, and so on and so forth. I'll know this from experience, and maybe you've had the same experience. The things I got in trouble with in my younger life, and even in my Christian life, was because who I hung around with. I wanted to be popular. I wanted to do this when I got in trouble, and so forth like that. And man alive, was it my fault? Yeah. I should have had more sense than to hang around the losers. I finally wised up and thought, what am I doing what you're doing for? You know, why am I doing that? Then the Christian has the same thing. Whether you're influenced by your relatives, whether you're influenced by your friends, there are a lot of times, and I've had Christian tell me this, you know what, when I started out and I told people that I was a Christian now, and I started going to church, and I wanted to do this and that, you know what they said? Said, you know what, well, that isn't going to bother. Come on down and have a drink with us. No, I don't want to do that. We led a fellow to the Lord. This girl came to me. We led her to the Lord. And she said, I'm one of the most wonderful guys that you ever met in your life. I said, and we need to get married. We want to get married. And I said, is he a Christian? She said, well, I don't really know. Well, I said, he's probably not then, because if he was, you'd know, you know? And so anyway, I said, bring Mark in. So she brought Mark in. Peach of a guy. I mean, this guy was a peach of a guy. Led him to the Lord. He was a Roman Catholic. Led him to the Lord. They did great. Married him. Come to church. It wasn't a month. Mark came back and he said, Pastor, I got to talk to you. I said, what's the matter, Mark? He said, my mother, every time I go home to visit her, she gets mad if I don't take a drink. She's drank all of her life. It's all right to drink. It's all right to drink. He said, I've drank enough to float a battleship. He said, I don't want to drink anymore. I don't want to drink anymore. I want to serve the Lord. The first thing that happened, he had to tell his mom, if I come back home again and you offer me a drink, it's the last time I'm coming home. But what I'm saying is this, the old nature you'll have until, and the spirit lusteth against the flesh and the flesh against the spirit, these two are contrary one to another, and every Christian has it, and every one of you have the old nature. But you have the Holy Spirit, which is the new nature, and you have a conflict that'll go on. Whichever one you feed the most is the one that's going to have the victory. If you never read the Bible, if you never have fellowship with other Christians, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life will begin to creep in. And pretty soon, you'll miss a Sunday. And pretty soon, next month, it'll be 2 Sundays. Next month, it'll be 3 Sundays, and so on and so forth like that. And pretty soon, you will be out of fellowship. You'll lose the happiness that you have. You've got to have fellowship. You've got to read your Bible. You've got to be around other Christians. And you've got to be in a church that teaches the Bible. That's feeding the new nature. Then you'll have the victory and enjoy your Christian life as God said, or Christ said, I'm come that you might have life, but I want you to have it abundantly. Enjoy your life. Have a good life. Enjoy it. Just put me first and I'll bless you for that. So much for that. Now, I want to get back and get on here. The other thing that was taught was this. And this is taught by John Ankerberg. And he had a man on there, Hugh, I can't think of his last name now, Hugh something.
Hugh Ross.
He believes that God created the first blob. And from that blob, everything evolved. That's what John Ankerberg has on there, and that's what he believes. That is absolutely false. So you had the contrast. You had the gap principle that was taught, which is correct. You had the other that was taught, evolution, therefore that we evolved, whether it's the first glob that was created or blob that was created, or whether you just slip from slime or come from scum out of the ocean, whatever, and all this garbage that's put out. So now you come up past the 20s and you have Ellen G. White, and she comes up here with this McCready guy, and he was an amateur geologist, George McCready Price, and they got together and thought that the Earth was only 6,000 years old and the same age as what man was when he was put on the Earth. That has come from Ken Ham all the way from Australia to America. He looked at America and thought these are the dumbest people, illiterate people on the Bible. This guy, as far as I know, never taught a Sunday school class. I never known him to go to Bible college. He is a scientist, and so forth. But he is very dynamic. He's a very dynamic speaker. He's a very thinking man on his feet. And he twists everything around, and people that have not been in a good Bible teaching church don't even have a chance in order to refute this man. When you get through here, you will not only have a chance to refute him, you will have a book that refutes him, and you will not follow this trash that's put out by this man who is a nothing but a millionaire and has all of his relatives working on there, so forth. You cannot find out how many millions he makes because he's not required by on his speaking tours and so forth. He's not required by the IRS to report that. The only thing he's required to report is how much he pays all of his relatives to work in that big museum down there and so forth like that. He is a con man from the word go. So, we're going to teach you how phony this guy is and how false teaching that this man has infiltrated. I should say home Bible studies, home teaching your children. He'll get in any place and anywhere he can, and we're going to cover all of that. Now, we've got a little time, but I want to go one more place before we get into that. We'll get into that next week to get into the scriptures on that. But I want to give you something else if I can do this, and that is you have where they say that the 7 days or the 6 days in recreation here, there, that these are a geological age. Other words, each day stands for maybe what other figure you want to throw out. Some will throw out, oh, maybe a day age is, the age could be 1,000 years, it could be 500,000 years, it could be 2 million, it could be any number they want to pick out, they can pick out and throw it, because they either do one or two things to impress you that they're right. One is, it's scientific. Number two is, he has a doctorate degree and he is a scholar. We always put scholar on that. Do you know how that you are labeled as a scholar? Do you know how you do that? There is no degree put out in any Bible college, anywhere, any place that gives you a scholar degree. There is none. We can put a scholar degree on anybody in our organization that has probably written a book or is a great speaker that goes around all over the country. We will now say, scholar so-and-so, this biblical scholar. So you're impressed because you think he cannot be wrong. Just like scientists put, it is scientifically proven. And you have no idea. Timothy warns about that. Science falsely so-called in the Bible. Don't believe this stuff. Believe what I say over what these degree men that have degrees say that contradicts the Bible. You are constantly attacked by Satan, by the philosophy that is put out here by these men on television and so forth. I studied a book. How many of you ever heard of H.G. Wells? Ever heard of him? Sure. And on his writing, he was an arch evolutionist. So anyway, I thought, I'm going to take a little time. I'm going to rush straight through his book. So when I went through his book, I took my red pencil, and I thought, I'm going to circle now because I want to see all the proof that H.G. Wells has. I came across, we are led to believe. I circled that. We can now assume. I circled that. And a few other little cliches there. And I'm thinking, you stupid idiot. I am led to believe because of what you said, that you don't have any proof. You're just led to believe by your philosophy of what you think according to this, which is not proof, but it leads you to summarize what you think it says, and then you're telling me we are led to believe, and you're using the pronoun we, which doesn't include me, sir, because I don't follow you, stupid idiot, because you contradict the Bible. We can assume. I'd circle that. What are you talking about? We can assume. Who's the we? It sure doesn't include me because I don't follow you, buddy. You're not eating a fruitcake. You're of Satan. You're trying to magnetize your philosophy and get me into believing what you assume. No facts whatsoever. So, you got all this stuff going on. So, first of all, we're going to cover some of that. Now, we have this in the book, but we'll give it to you out here. Some of you don't have the book. First of all, you have proof on a day age that a day. Genesis chapter 1 is a geological age instead of a 24-hour day. We'll go through some of that. First of all, proof by biblical context. If you go to Genesis, I'd like for you to go there in your Bible. If you got it there, Genesis chapter 1, all right? Just turn your Bibles, Genesis chapter 1. We'll get through this here a little bit here, okay? In Genesis chapter 1. Okay, if you begin to look here, Genesis chapter 1, look in verse 5. Let's go down to verse 5, okay? In chapter 1, notice in verse 5, my text is small. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Evening and the morning. Well, that's interesting, isn't it? Huh? Verse 5. Then we come on, and you'll find the same thing in verse 8, 13, 19, 23, and 31. Evening and the morning were the first day. Now, that's very interesting. Evening and the morning were the first day, the second day, the third day, and so forth. He did not say the evening and the morning were a geological age. I think God knows the difference between a geological age of 500,000 years and a 24-hour day, don't you? I think so. And then we find out, what better context or definition could a person ask of God than a day consists of light, darkness, divided by evening and morning, just as we have today? Some say a day and night were longer than that now, but if you go and you look in Psalms chapter 136 in verse 5, 8, and 9, here's what we read. The sun was shining in the daytime, or let me say this, to him that by wisdom in verse 5 made the heavens. The sun to rule by day, verse 8, and the moon and the stars to rule by night. The sun was shining in the daytime while the psalmist was living, just as it was when man was created and just as it is now. It's the same with the moon, the stars by night. Nothing has changed in the length of days, the time that God created man. Not one thing. Proof as spoken by Christ. Number two. You'll find out in John chapter 1, or John chapter 11, verse 9, about 2,000 years ago, Christ made it clear that a day is composed of 24 hours. just as it has been from creation, God's creation, until the time right now. Jesus said in John chapter 11, verse 9, are there not 12 hours in a day? It's very interesting, isn't it? 12 hours in a day. Do not 12 hours in the daytime and 12 hours in the night make up 24 hours in a day? I believe it does. Number 3, you see how that geological age theory contradicts the Bible? Proof by the flood. Approximately 1600 years after the creation of man, the earth was destroyed by a universal flood. We know that. At this time, God used years, months, days, and numbers, just as we have today, to tell us when the rains of the flood began. He uses that. Now, we go on down, and let's look here in Genesis chapter 7, verse 11. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, 17th day of the month, the same day, all of the fountains of the great deep were broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days. That's 12 hours and 40 nights, 12 hours. Therefore, a 24-hour days, just as we have today. God uses that. Now, proof by botany. This is interesting. What about that? This is unbelievable that someone would say, a scientist, that a day is a geological age of 200,000 years, 500,000 years. And let me just say this, folks, this is no joke. They pick out any period of time they want and throw it in your face. And because they are scientific, then, or they're a scholar, those two things are the two most words that are used in the English language to convince you to believe this man, who is just a man created by God, coming up with this garbage, his philosophy, and he puts either he's a scholar or he's a scientist, and you're supposed to believe it. God told Timothy, you write and tell him if you don't believe in this. Proof by botany, and then we'll come to a conclusion here, okay? In Genesis chapter 1, God said he created man on the sixth day. If a day is as the evolutionists claim, you would have 250,000 years of total darkness and 250,000 years of light. Then, let me ask you a question. Can you explain how all of the animals, plants, and human life could survive for 250,000 years in total darkness? There would be no fruits, vegetables, trees, as nothing would be able to grow without sunlight. Nothing. Another thing to consider, plants and animals have to have a balance in nature. Both are essential for each other and the survival of both. Animals take in oxygen and give off carbon dioxide, do they not? Animals have to have plants to give off just the opposite there. Plants take in carbon dioxide, they give off oxygen. Neither one can survive without the other. So if you have, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 11 and 12, God brought forth all of the vegetation on the third day. In Genesis chapter 1, in verse 21 to 23, God created on the fifth day all of the creatures and the winged fowl, verses 24 and 25. God made the animals that require oxygen produced by vegetation. Plants need carbon dioxide to live, which is given off by the animals, and since many of the evolutionists claim a day is 500,000 years, they would disprove their own claim as plants and animals could not survive at all. This is the difference of knowing what the Bible says and knowing true science, as compared to these idiots out here that hate God and try to siphon all this garbage into your children's minds when a science class or a science teacher that believes in evolution wants to get a hold of your child and teach them scientific things, which some of them are nothing but trash that attack the Word of God. No wonder mothers and dads are homeschooling their children today and don't want that trash put into their children's mind. You're very smart. I'm not saying that's the answer for everyone. This is a choice that parents make and so forth. Whether they send them, some send them to schools and then counteract what they're taught when they get home and so forth. Others don't want them subjected to that. And that's truly up to the parent to do. I don't get involved in that. That's the parent's choice, one way or the other, you see. Agricultural science proves that vegetables, trees cannot survive even for a short period of time, let alone 500,000 years without animals. The evolutionists refuse to believe true science findings, yet they want you to believe their false theories. How preposterous. Now, we'll stop there. There are about three or four more things to prove that a day in Genesis chapter 1, or a day anywhere, and I'll just throw this out, this is free. Anytime you find a number before a day, it is always in the Bible from Genesis to the end to the book of Revelation, a 24-hour day. Just keep that in mind. One of the numbers before the day, it is always a 24-hour day. When the ark rested on the 17th day, that was the 17th day, that's a 24-hour day. It's amazing when the ark rested after the back of Christ on the 17th day. It was the 14th day that Christ was crucified, and on the 17th day he arose. The ark was the perfect type, and it's not by accident that the ark rested, which is the type of Christ, on the same day that Jesus Christ had risen from the dead. Isn't it wonderful what God has put in the Bible for you to know the truth? These things will continue on. It'll be very interesting because there's going to be many, many messages on this as we go through. And we'll take the Hebrew and make it very simple for you. Alright, so that you will understand it. Very, very simple on that. Now, the most important thing is, our time's gone. Do you know for sure you're going to heaven when you die? That's great. One lady just, yep, I know it right in the congregation. She's excited. Well, we know that too. And it is exciting to know that you're going to heaven. And the reason that you know that and it's exciting is because we don't know how long we got to live. You know, we can live till the rapture. We hope that we can. I hope I can, you know. So, but if I can, you got to hurry up the rapture, dear Lord, you know. I'm not getting any younger, you know. So, but isn't it wonderful to be able to talk to the Lord and do that? But let me illustrate this for you that maybe have not heard the simplicity of the gospel. First of all, you don't have to ask Jesus to save you. Why? He's already told you how to be saved. What are you asking him to do? One man has a radio broadcast on one of the radio stations there. He says, and trust Jesus as your Savior, and may God help you. And I, Marcy and I, we listened to that and said, how's God going to help you? I mean, he wrote it in the Bible. I mean, what's he going to do? Well, how can he help you other than give you the Word of God? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. In Romans 10:17, is that not right? Right. So if I read it in the Word of God that loves the world and gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life, how in the world is God going to help me to believe when I'm reading it and I have a choice to either believe it or not believe it? How's God going to help me? He gave me the Word. He said, if you believe it, you'll never perish and have everlasting life. He never takes away your free will to make that decision on whether you want to accept him or reject him. And he can do no more than put it in the Bible for you to read, or a Christian witnessing to you to tell you, if you believe that my Son died on that cross and paid for your sins, you will never perish but have eternal life. And if you don't want to believe it, then you'll spend eternity in hell and hear the Lord say, when you die, depart from me, you're cursed into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Let me illustrate the billfold sin. God says, Max Jounce, I don't want you to go to hell and pay for your sin. Please, I'm not willing you should perish, what Peter said. God said, I'm not willing you should perish either. You know, I don't want you to die and pay for your sins in hell, because I paid for them over 2,000 years ago, and I have the record in the Bible. Right here. He rose from the dead, which means God accepted his payment for the sins of the world. Now, this hand represents Christ, no sin. And he said, I gave my only begotten Son. He came down, took on a human body without sin. He went to the hell of the cross so that you wouldn't have to go to a literal hell. He paid for all your sins. God raised him from the dead, accepted his payment for the sins of the world. Now, you have God here that paid for your sins. You are standing here with your sins not paid for. Now, A transaction is made when you believe the record God gave of his son. Dear Lord, I believe you died on the cross to pay for my sins. I believe that. The minute you do that, he takes your sin and marks them eternally now, positionally. Every sin you'll ever commit in the future, eternally, is paid for. What you commit after you're saved, you have to pay the price for. You'll suffer loss of rewards at the judgment seat of Christ. But at salvation, he takes your sin paid, and he gives you his righteousness. So I'm found in him, Christ, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but the righteousness which is by faith in Jesus Christ. So every one of you that have your faith in Christ, you will never go to hell, and you'll hear the Lord and those angels come and say, come inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world or the earth. Because Jesus Christ paid for your sins, you will never go to hell to do it. Come, and you'll meet Jesus Christ face to face. You'll want to hug him so much. You'll see all the angels in the glory of heaven, the seraphims, the cherubims. You'll see things you never dreamed of. Absent from the body, present with the Lord, there is no purgatory. Purgatory is the biggest money ripoff ever devised by organized religion to take your money and send you to hell. That's what Catholicism does. Aren't you glad you're saved and know you're going to heaven? Mm-hmm. No purgatory. A home's waiting for you. A home's waiting for me. Don't rush it, Lord. But I have a home. Amen. Amen. I have a home. Let's just put on a word of prayer. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you can bow your head or you can just look right into that DVD. You don't have to bow your head. But you have to believe that Christ said just how, dear Lord, I believe you died for me. I'm so happy to know that I don't have to go to hell. I believe that you died for me. Dear Lord, thank you for all that you do. Give us a good day today. Thank you for each one here today. I just thank you so much. I thank you for the wonderful spirit that we have. And just learning these things are just, you know, it's just thrilling to learn what God has in the Bible and to know these things. And most of all, dear Lord, we pray, even so come, Lord Jesus, that if you come this afternoon after the Super Bowl, then we'll be ready to go. Thank you. Bless each one here in Jesus' precious name. Amen.